Cooney. I'm your art Sherpa, and this is live how to paint and draw a kawaii panda. I'm kind of excited about it because this is a lesson I have been on the hook for my eldest daughter for, because she's really into kawaii pandas. On the control booth today is my sweet and adorable husband, John. Say hi, John.
Hey, guys.
How are you guys doing today? I'm ready to get my art on.
Are you ready to get your art on?
I think we got the Breakfast Club in here today.
We got artists.
All the artists coming in replay. We love you guys. We know you have schedules and jobs, and it is important to, you know, eat. So we understand if you can't make the live show, but when you can make live shows, try to, because it's a pretty special experience. I think YouTube art has the best community of viewers, bar none, anywhere on YouTube. I mean, I'm not trying to start nothing with gaming, but I'm sorry, guys. We just have, like, the best group of viewers ever.
Mm-hmm. We do.
Yeah. So, win.
Yep.
I'm sporting some really cool jewelry my husband just got me. Loot Crate. Not a sponsor video. It's just where we got it.
It was Loot Crate score.
Yeah. They're cool, though. Unsponsored. They pay other people to say this, but not us. We just really, really like... This is my Katniss Everdeen. I don't know if anybody... Okay. Off topic. So in the description, you'll see links to a traceable, right? If you're like, I just don't want to draw it. And it's actually also a coloring page. And you're going to see a link to the picture. Because sometimes it's hard to just, I just recently painted with my friend Angela Anderson and my other friend Lindsay the Frugal Crafter. And that experience of painting along with them has taught me having a little picture up on the screen or someplace that you can see it is super helpful for journey.
And well, we could put it up right here. See, this is what we're going to be doing.
This is what we're doing today.
Yeah, the kawaii panda.
Kawaii. Kawaii panda. My daughter would be like, she's
we
so
got
cute.
A full house today.
We do. What do we have?
Well, Lindsay's here, and Mark is here, and Mona is here.
Hi, Lindsay,
Kim
hi,
is
Mark,
here.
And Mona.
And Kathy, and I think I saw Jane, and I think I saw Karen. I mean, it's Jane and oh gosh, Underdog's here. Reed, Rhea, Brad. I mean, I just go on
it's
and on.
It's a party
and
in the Heart Party House
they're
today.
They're scrolling so fast, I can't see everyone. But they got wishes ready.
We do. Awesome. I'm ready to do wishes. If you're new to what we do here, yeah, I teach this whole painting step by step, but one of the things that we like to do is put wishes into our canvas. I encourage you to put a wish into your canvas at home. Because I'm painting such a light pastel canvas today, I'm going to do my wishes on the back, is what my plan is. And I know we have a wish for Jared. Have you seen that?
I've seen a wish for Jane. But there's been a lot of wishes scrolling by, so I think
that's Jane's son is he's having an appendectomy.
Ah, okay.
And in our family, that's actually my Mama Hoot. My mom had her appendix rupture, and it was really quite a journey because she had it happen on a cruise ship.
Mm-hmm.
And if y'all wondering how tough my mom is, she had peritonitis for 24 hours. She went shopping. It was. She's like, when my mom says I don't feel well, it's like, it's a big deal. And so I know how that is, and I know what that recovery's like. And so I'm going to wish for Jared a fabulous appendectomy. They can happen in a really quick and speedy recovery. And here's the secret wish that you might not know, is that food starts tasting really good again really soon. So we're going to wish Jared recovers. Quickly.
Yes.
And food tastes tasty. It's a weird side effect of that, but food can take a little while to come back. Do we have any other wishes, John?
Oh, gosh, let's see here. I was busy paying attention to, let's see, I saw a wish for another grandson. We have a wish for a grandson.
To have one?
A wish for my grandson.
Oh.
Was just found out that she had a brain tumor and is having is kidney failure. So we're going to put a wish for health there.
Yeah. A return to full health.
Yeah, for Sydney's grandson. Cindy. Oh, it's Cindy's grandmother. There we go. I misread that.
Cindy's grandmother.
For Cindy's grandmother. That's a big difference between Cindy's grandson and Cindy's grandmother. So
I know I had, we had one of our younger viewers just recently wish, and she felt, you guys do such, you know, beautiful heartfelt wishes, and she was feeling a little bad for this, but like I say, there's silly wishes are as valid as serious wishes, and mm-hmm. she's hoping for some new upgraded art supplies.
Yes.
For the holidays. So we're wishing that in general, art supplies into our community, but for her especially. I'm writing with a gold Sharpie today, so like, you know.
Hmm. Well, and we had a another wish for there to be more NFAW weekends. I'm not sure what that is, but Rhea was wishing for it. So.
Rhea is wishing for more N.
FAW weekends.
AW weekends. I don't know what that is. And now I'm feeling kind of bad because I feel like it's like some sort of art council or something. But
well, I don't think it's the National Financial Advisors Week. But, I mean, which is what comes
maybe
to mind.
Maybe it is.
Maybe it is.
Maybe the National Financiers Advisors Week is like off the chain. Maybe it could be. Are just having bananas fun. And it's just on like Donkey Kong
it
up in there.
It could be. It could be. They're just, you know. We're just having fun. So good wishes for all of that. A wish for Crystal.
Crystal.
And I there's a healing wish for Crystal. New chemo. So we wish.
She's going through chemo.
I'm trying to scroll up real quick just to read.
Okay.
It,
yeah. Go ahead.
Here.
We've got time. It's important. You're important. It's important. Your wishes and your dreams are important.
So we want to wish for Crystal that the new chemo that they're putting on her works better than the last one.
Oh, yes.
That's what we want to get.
Well, you know, it goes medication by medication, so that we're going to put some hearts on that one there.
Well, I think and Rhea told us what NFAW is.
Are we scared now?
I could have it. No, but it is. It's actually something great. It's the Netherlands Film Acting Weekend for Kids. And so.
Netherlands for having a film acting weekend for kids.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's cool. Well, we're all for good wishes for that.
Good wishes for that. Isn't that, you know, I wish we had more theater here. We don't have enough theater here.
Hmm.
John, outing John again.
No, don't.
Yeah, no, yeah, he was initially, before he was a high-energy physics major, he was a theater major who played rugby. However, could have ended up dating him. So cute.
So what's your sippy-sippy? Your
Seriously, I'm not trying to start some controversy. I'm drinking out of the red cup because it's a cup.
It's a cup.
As long as they put my coffee in a cup, I'm okay with it.
Yeah, it just sounds okay.
I am. I'm not trying to start nothing with the world or nothing, and we all know I love the holidays. It's just my coffee cup from my Nat. I'm so addicted to them. Is anyone else really like unusually hooked on Starbucks?
Unusually?
I
think anybody who pays $4 for a cup of coffee is unusually hooked on coffee. I'm just saying.
Help me.
Just saying.
Help me. It's such a problem. And I've tried to quit. And I have a K-Cup machine, which I do love.
I feel guilty using the K-Cup machine.
That's bad. It's a problem. And it's been ongoing years.
I think it's great.
Is there support?
I like Starbucks just generally. They seem to be reasonable.
We do art here. If you're coming on the replay, don't click away. You can fast forward through all my nonsense if you're like, I just want to paint this Kawaii Panda.
Okay. We'll paint the Kawaii Panda.
We're going to paint the Kawaii Panda. I'm going to be sketching him in today. With watercolor pencils. We changed up how our format is down there. You guys will have to let us know. So the materials list and the links are like the first thing.
Yeah.
And so I really love these watercolor pencils, but you could do chalk. What you want is something that will not tint your paint and will go away as you paint. So chalk and watercolor pencils. There's some really cool expensive options. I got these at Michael's for very, like, artist loft, very inexpensive. Are y'all liking, if you hadn't seen it already, liking my new microphone? Ooh. Lindsay, do you like my new microphone? I got new sound. Sorry. It's, you know, some people get new shoes and I get new head kit. So
we're still playing
about
with
that.
We're still playing with it. We're having fun with it. We've got it kind of moved out this time so she can sip and paint.
How's the sound working? Is it okay? Because we had a little light last time and we also have to keep it above my...
I said, don't do that. It hurts my ears.
I'm sorry. That's why.
So
apparently I'm very breathy.
Okay, we're going to paint for a little while, and then at the next break, I'll talk about some of the cool stuff.
Okay, so this is an 8x10 canvas board. And I think that these are really great if you are, especially if you're painting with little brushes, because they're sturdy. They'll hold up and they frame really easily, so you can keep it. But it's not as expensive as, say, canvas. And it's a very nice compromise. I have acrylic paint today. Obviously, any brand of acrylic paint is okay. I like to paint, you know, pro brands, and I really work my cells so I can do that. It's really just the best paint that you can afford, and each of the paints have features and detractors, and you just have to figure out what works for you. And I'm Liquitex and Golden and Matisse today. And, are we going to have the Quinacridone? I said it!
You did?
I said Quinacridone! Thank you, guys! So, we'll start out with the palette. Quinacridone Magenta, which Angela brought into our lives, and now I need to use up the tube. So guess what? You guys need to use up the tube. No, actually, I really like it. I'm glad we introduced it.
Okay.
Phthalo Blue, Cad Red, not Cad Red, that's a yellow. Hello, eyes, how are you? Cad Yellow Medium. Hue is a good place to save money, and if you're painting with kids, please switch to Hue. Titanium White and Mars Black. I have a cup of water, and I have assorted acrylic brushes, and they're all going to be a little bit smaller. This is probably, you know, about this size. Let me do the, Do I have it? No, I don't. There it is. I love doing this. I feel so YouTube-tacular when I do it. My nail's all messed up.
Your nails are all messed up.
A little bit.
The rhinestones popped off. Well, they're working nails.
So I'll show you this again. This is what we're doing. John can pop that picture up at different times, too, so you guys can really see it.
I can just squash you with that picture.
You can. And I'm hopefully, I hear Greta outside. She's telling the neighbors to just, she going to get them.
Yeah.
She likes to tell the neighbors, I'm going to get you.
But we have so much better mics now. You can't hear as much. You'll have to zoom out a little bit so we can.
Okay. You want me to zoom out a little?
Just a little.
We're going to get, we're working on getting one of these that does this at the button at the control booth.
it's you know, and we'll talk about that a little later.
About 2 inches up, I'm going to make a little mark. And over here on the bottom left, I'm going to come over about an inch in. And this is kind of fun. This is sort of this like low running downhill that's going to come down. Right? A little running little hill. And he's a hoot and a half to draw in because really he's sort of a squashy egg.
Can you push that down a little harder? It's
you know what?
Light.
I can. I'm seeing that too.
Yeah, I know that, you know, it's a.
No. I'm going to. You don't sketch this dark. Thank you, John. You don't sketch this dark. I'm going to sketch really dark.
Yeah, we can paint over it.
We'll paint over it. Can we see that?
Yeah.
Is that showing
really
up? Do I need to switch to a black?
No, you can really see it there in the in,
all right.
In the close-up.
So I'm going to sketch in my little squashy, sort of fat little squashy egg shape. And when I say egg, it's just slightly pointed at the top. And then it's as if a egg-shaped beanbag has resided its little self on the hill is what we're going for here. Egg-shaped beanbag. And you can really, like, play it out and sketch it out. When I get my shape where I really like it, I will press down hard and, you know, all my little Kawaii pandas are slightly different at the zoo. So I'm going to draw this darker than I would want you to draw it, but just so that you could see it. Okay. Can you guys see that?
Yeah, I think we can see that coming in.
Right. And you can round it out up here if you want to. This is lots to play with. Don't get it too pointy. It's just a titch narrower. And this is real easy. This is like the handle off a teapot or a backwards letter C. I'm going to give an ear here. I'm going to come over to the other side and give an ear here. This is a little bit like bear stack. See there?
Yeah.
Now, the little paws couldn't be easier. They're just quarter-sized circles. He's a really easy one to put in. You can go silver dollar. You know, and again, you sketch light because I'm going to have to get rid of this later.
Yeah. So,
you know, you sketch a little lighter than I am because you can see it in your own studio. It's just the lighting and everything that we have here that makes it hard. Right. And so we have these two little feet sticking out here and just a quarter of an inch below his ear. We're going to come out and make a little bump out and curve down. I don't know. It's almost like a squishy, melty candy corn. Yes, this is a, I don't know, I maybe you guys haven't melted candy corns. So you're like, I don't know what that would look like. But if you have, it's kind of, it kind of has that little shape. I'm also thinking it's kind of like In the Night Garden, some of the creatures from In the Night Garden. Little squashy. And then there's another little paw that's going to come down and touch his little bear belly. Because bears always like, I grew up on Winnie the Pooh, so I just believe that bears are just round, soft, cuddly. Not in real life. Living in Canada, I ran into some actual bears.
They're very cuddly and soft looking.
But yeah, but don't touch them.
Don't
touch the bears. There's the funniest. I wish I had the graphic loaded up for you. We have the funniest graphic that the park rangers put up in Canada about like what will happen to you. It was like a pictorial comic really strip of what would happen to you, and then the bear, if you fed the bear, it had like a guy feeding a bear, and it had then the bear attacking the guy, and then it had the ranger shooting the bear. It's so bad. It's just like. Like, they really wanted you to understand the series of events that would, if you just gave that bear a Snickers.
That's right.
They were very, and I know it was coming from a very loving place, and I shouldn't laugh, but it was just, I'll post up on Facebook or something. We'll you guys have to see it on the Facebook group.
I think we'll probably have to have a little, a live QA session after this.
Are we?
Yeah.
I'll try to, I'm gonna find that picture for you guys. It just, it really set my experience in Canada. I think it was one of our first Canadian things we did because we went up to the mountain to see snow because the kids had never seen snow. We're in Texas, so we don't have it. Hmm. Okay, so that's his little eyes. See, they're just these little circles right here. And they're smaller than a diamond. I like to make them not completely even. Sometimes you can make one higher or lower than the other. And that's really all it takes to get in your little bear panda that you've got to do. And then the painting in part is incredibly easy. I'm going to get a smaller, what have I washed? I don't know if you guys ever have this experience, but you're just like down to, what have I been washing? I don't know what I've washed. I'm going to use this half, oh, there it is. There you are. I'm just going to use this. Okay, so this is a brush by Creative Mark. And they have it lit enabled number 12, but I don't know. We need to have a big brush summit. I think get a bunch of the people I know and have a brush summit because there really isn't standard brush sizing and it's company by company. So that's why I'm always like this and like say, look, with my nail, that's how big it is. Just some size relationship. So when you're looking at brushes, you can size them. This is a bright and that means it's got a nice sharp square edge. And I'm going to mix a very light sky blue. Now, the big thing is, guys, don't scoop from the center of your paint. Okay, and when you're holding your brushes, I'm going to show just real quick how to hold brushes. I want you to use, especially if you're a little brush, I want you to use your pinchers. You can come and do your pinchers. And I want you to hold it like this, relaxed, where your fingers are touching the ferrule. Try not to paint from back here because it's going to be crazy.
Yes.
So you want to get your tripod and pinch it. Take from the outside of your paint pops, real slow amounts. I know that can be hard sometimes when you're younger. And actually, even when you're just new to painting, because it just is so fun to get into the paint and swirl it around. And you pull a little bit out, and then you're going to come mix it to the side. See how I'm working the side? I'm going to dip in the water a little bit and mixing from the side. And it takes such a small amount of blue, as you can see, to tint this white. And then I'm going to start painting this in horizontal brush strokes. And if I need to, I'll dip my brush in water for flow. Oh, good, that's up here. So if you're really new to painting, what you're looking to be doing is having a fairly fluid stroke. And you don't want, let me see if I can make it do it. Okay, I've got it kind of going here. See how, I'm going to zoom way in.
Yeah.
Okay. See how that's skipping over the canvas here? So all that's happened here is that you don't have enough water and paint on your brush. So if you start seeing that, and this happens to everybody, don't feel like, you know, there's something crazy going on with you. I've been in a bunch of classes. They'll just be working themselves to death with a dry brush. What are we doing? Am I doing something wrong? Oh, John is adjusting. Hey, stunt hands. Come here, stunt hands. Stunt hands. John's going to give us some stunt hands and show us. Yes, yeah, see, any pair of hands can do this. Even stunt hands. Thank you, stunt hands. Sorry. What is going on with us today? What is going on with us? I am. Yeah, definitely come by for the Q&A after, because we'll do some happy mail, and I'll tell you about some of the really cool art projects and YouTubery that I'm involved in coming up this holiday season. There's some amazing stuff. Amazing. And I love sharing with you what's happening.
So Lindsay thinks that that she may have some rhyme and reason to the brushes.
Oh my gosh, Lindsay, if you do, I would be thrilled to know the rhyme and reason.
So what she says is she thinks that brush sizing, the nylons are on a standard scale, but the hogs are on a much larger scale, and she's found that synthetics to be relative between brands.
Really?
And maybe in millimeters.
Huh. I will check that out. I will go into the art store on Art Safari, Lindsay. I will go into the art store on Art Safari, because I've kind of gone in there before with some measuring sticks, and I've talked to some paint companies about it. And I'm going to measure that out and see if that's true. Because if we could figure out a standard way of explaining it, because it's really frustrating when people like say, I bought a 4 and they have a completely different brush size. That like really freaks me out. Because I was like, that doesn't even look like 4 millimeters. So are you saying it's the length? Is she saying it's the length of the or the width of the brush?
You know, the comment came up while I was playing Stunt Hands, so I have to go back and read it.
You know, and this is why. This is why artists need to talk to each other.
This is.
It really, really is. And Lindsay, I'm sure you're familiar with the Frugal Crafter, but if you're not, you should make yourself. She has some of the best product reviews. She reviews all kinds of products, like stuff I've never heard of, all kinds of things, because she crafts and paints. So she gets exposed to a lot of different art materials.
Yes.
Which is very, very cool. You know. So definitely, definitely check her out.
So she just screwed up, scrolled up and said width of the ferrule.
Okay.
So. All of her. Oh, gosh, man. All of her number 12 nylons seem to be about half an inch.
Huh.
So she's looking at patterns.
Thank you.
Maybe she actually is talking to brush manufacturers as well.
Well, you know, I remember we went through all those things where I, you know, called them and wrote them.
Yeah. They were all like, what?
And they were like, no, we don't know what's going on. I was like, well, if you guys don't know, I don't know what to tell anybody else. But see, that's what we have Lindsay for. Thank you. So I guess I have a thing here. Well, just totally do this. Well, I don't know if you guys are interested.
But we're bringing you along for the ride.
We're bringing you along for the ride. So is the top, oh no, I don't have millimeters. I have centimeters.
And that's okay. Centimeters are just 10 times.
So this is okay, I can line this up. I can do this. 1 centimeter. Good. And it's 12 on the brush.
That's actually closer to a 12. Yeah, so that's... Put that back up there.
Okay.
And let's look at about a half inch, I'm guessing.
No, it's smaller than a half inch. I'll put it back up to the inch thing. It's almost a half inch.
But look, you have to indent the...
Yeah.
Yeah, that's about right. So that's consistent with what she's finding.
Okay. That is very, very helpful. That is very, very, very helpful. Thank you, Lindsay.
Yeah, so that... I'm going to come over and look at that, because that may be that it's 12 millimeters or 1.2.
Well, you know, and I had asked Creative Mark when I was talking to them, I had asked them, well, is it on millimeters? What are they using? And they said, well, some of the companies are using millimeters, but all of them are not.
Maybe. I'm sure that probably the lesser manufacturers are not, but it may be that the bigger ones are.
Well, it would make sense. I mean, what the heck is the number for, right?
We wax philosophically about brushes.
Okay, and we should
Day.
Be teaching, you know, people to paint this in. So I'm painting a smooth coat. paint stuff is interesting.
It is.
I am really deep into Victoria Finley's book on color right now, and I'm just having a blast. Paint is interesting. I was talking to John about how people walked 3 days, just, 50,000 years ago for, like, the color red to trade.
That's pretty crazy.
Yeah, and only certain people could carry it. It's just really fascinating, like, how we relate to color.
Yeah, I think it was Cleopatra made the color purple popular, right?
I don't know that. That is a fact you may have that I don't have.
Yeah, and it's apparently the way that they made purple at that time was very interesting. Because it was from rotten shellfish.
Oh, yeah.
And urine.
There's a... Okay, first of all, y'all, I'm going to... I don't know if you're with your kids, this is educational. But there's a shocking amount of urine used in paint manufacture.
Well, you got to get that ammonia.
That's how they used to get ammonia. And so a huge amount of the dyeing process required pee. And there was a lot of mythology about, like, redhead pee being having more efficacy than other pee. And... Just like, I think they teach the wrong history in school.
Seriously.
Because I think if you said to a bunch of kids, do you think redheaded pee would help blue dye set better? They would be paying attention, wouldn't they?
I think so.
So I'm just doing nice smooth strokes. And some tricks that you can do to make this better is on this... Even though this is a very graphic piece, I'm kind of keeping my strokes horizontal. I'm not going all crazy. You know how sometimes I go crazy? Lindsay's like, wait, is she talking about pee? She's like, I thought we were talking about brush sizes. What's up here today?
Welcome to the show.
Welcome to the show.
So what book were you talking about earlier, the color book?
Yeah, it's Victoria Finley has written several books on color.
Mm-hmm.
My mom actually found her first and got me into it. And it's like, it's better than a soap opera. It's better than True Blood. It's better than anything that's on TV because it's shocking.
Oh, wow.
It's shocking what happened. Like, the big bug butt conspiracy for the color red. Huge conspiracy.
Huh. Did you know that Mark is on Periscope painting with us right now?
Mark is on Periscope painting with us right now. Scopey, scopey, Mark. Scopey, scope. Periscope is a live streaming service app that you can put on your phone if you have not heard of it. And it's real new right now in 2015. So, like, if this video is up for a while and you're painting the Kawaii Panda in a few years, you'll be like, what's
Periscope?
Well, hopefully. I think they're hoping, like, everyone's going to know what Periscope is in 2015. We got a sippy sippy.
Ooh.
Thank you for that information, Lindsay. I really appreciate it. Thank you. I'm going to check that out. Mm. Drinking from the controversy cup. I think they made that up. Somebody suggested to me it was like a made up drama on Facebook by the company.
Oh, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Hmm.
It seems reasonable to me.
Could be.
All right. So we've got that nice, happy little sky painted in. It's just a happy blue sky. And now we're going to make some very soft green. Very, very soft green. And it's going to be a little more yellow than it is blue. And what I mean by that is if I had a lot of blue in here, it becomes a very, very deep dark green. See that? With a blue tint. But I want it to be more yellow. Can we see the difference between those two?
Yeah, I think so.
Is that showing up? So that's what I'm talking about when I'm saying more to the yellow. And as I add more yellow, it would get more yellow. And as I add more blue, it would get more blue. And I'm going to add a little white to it. And that's how we're going to get the pastel color. When you're painting kawaii pieces, pastels are a key component of that. Soft pastel colors. I'm going to see I have a little too much of the darker paint on my brush. But I'll just pick up a little white. And I'm going to smoothly paint that in. This technique today, there's a little more water on the brush. So the paint is fluid. If you were doing craft paint, you wouldn't have any problem getting this fluidity. Or if you were doing any of the soft-bodied acrylics. So see... But I'm not worried about it being what I like to call a Home Depot color, which is just so uniform that there's no streakiness. Mm-hmm. This is painting. It should be a little streaky, unless we decide it shouldn't. unless we decide it shouldn't.
So it looks like Mark was used the traceable.
And Mark used the traceable?
Yeah.
How was the traceable, Mark?
So you want to see?
Yeah. Wait, we get to see? Oh my gosh, Lindsay. We're going to, wait, are we trying it? Oh, it's in the phone. I thought you were doing picture. It's a periscope.
You can see Mark's in there doing periscope right now.
Woohoo! Oh my gosh. Hey, Mark. Let's give him some hearts. There's four people in there. Dude, would you share it? I mean, we're always like, share, like, comment, and subscribe. You gotta share too.
I just thought that was great that Mark was painting along.
I really liked your ornament, especially the refilm, Lindsay. I thought it was really, really good. That was a really cool project with you and Steve Ramsey from Mere Mortals. Lindsay just did a really cool project with a YouTuber she introduced me to, Steve Ramsey. I just really enjoy his channel so much. I think he has the funniest promoted videos. Like, I just die. I don't know if Lindsay feels the same way. I'm just like, I'm on the floor. I love how he does the razor thing. I'm so into it. Not to do spoilers for anybody that discovers the channel, but they just did one of Lindsay's 12 days of Craftsmas. And, oh, it was really cute the way the collab went. I thought it was, where is that going? Stay here. Do not go nowhere. So this is a very big easel for this canvas. So we have that in. And I don't know, I really enjoyed it. And I thought it was really good. And it's really hard to do live. And she was such a pro that she went and refilmed her really cool project. And I think it ended up being even cooler and better for that.
Mm.
So if you're needing to make some ornaments, you know, you could paint this. You could use Lindsay's technique and paint this and give this as some ornaments.
Yeah.
Mash it up. Like glee.
Art mashup.
Art mashups. I love when you guys do art mashups. I love when I see you guys take some aspect of a project from one place. Now, I'm going to zoom in on this so you can really see what I'm doing here on these blades of grass. Okay. So here's the thing. I've got a detail brush.
Oh, yeah, there you are.
I go this way. Detail brush. And it is a 6. So maybe it's a 6 in circumference. It's a 6. And how I do this is the hardest part of my pressure, the hardest part that I'm pressing down into my canvas, is at the beginning of the stroke. And then as I flick and curve up, I lighten my pressure. And that's how I get those funny little grass blades. That's all it takes to get those. And that can be real challenging. By the way, this will get you eyelashes. This will get you whiskers. This is just sort of that fundamental little stroke. And if you're painting with somebody who's really young, one of the things that you can do is you can warm up on a piece of paper. It is okay to warm up. I mean, not that I exercise, but I hear people do that in exercise. I hear they warm up.
You have to pull your close-up camera over there just a little bit.
Just over there a little bit?
Yeah.
There you go. And we're just putting some of these little blowy grass blades on our hill. Just a little bit of those. It's kind of fun. Have a good time with it. You can, if you've got a little of this darker color, you can mix it into your mixture and just add some small, not a huge amount of tonality, because this art style is not known for that. But just to add some interesting dimension. You know, you can pick up more yellow, pick up more white, and just make some different. Whoa, that's too much white. See, that happens to everybody. Just gonna paint it away. You know, just mix it up a little bit and have some fun. Just mix it up and have some fun. I think that's so adorable, Mark's on Periscope.
Yeah, where you're painting, where your phone is?
My phone?
Yeah.
It is in my purse turned off, so Mom doesn't call me in the middle of a broadcast like she always does.
Ah, well.
Not intentionally. It's just when she thinks of, like, I should call my daughter. she's like, oh, now. She boots me on Periscope all the time.
I was going to share from your phone, too, but we're okay.
Oh, yeah. We're okay. Well,
I shared for him.
Yeah, Periscope.
Everyone, we doubled numbers.
I'm sipping. Sippy from the controversy cup.
We love it, man. This is a fun little painting.
Is it?
Yeah.
And it's just happy.
It's a happy little painting.
I think Bob Ross would approve. I think he would say, very happy, Cinnamon. Very happy.
And I'll put this up here, so that's what
I'm
we're doing.
I'm kind of giving him like a that'll do, babe sort of thing in my head.
And if you need access to the traceable or that reference photo, they're right at the top of the description below for you to get access to, as well as your material list. So let us know if that's easy enough for you guys to find.
And listen, if you don't have Quinacridone, Lindsay should be so proud of me. I could not say that the whole day. The other day, I'm like, was Quetzalcoatl, Quetzalcoatl. It was like Passamaquoddy. I just went Pete's Dragon on it all the whole time. If you don't have that red, for the purposes of this painting, any red, really any blue, any yellow, will work because you're just trying to mix these primary colors. And this is a good way to sort of introduce some of this color mixing to little brushes everywhere. Now, I'm going to have to sort of work my, because I got to sketching pretty light. See what I'm doing here? How I'm taking a wet brush and I'm sort of...
Erasing.
I'm erasing this. Yeah, this is why I like these watercolor pencils for sketching in onto a canvas. I used to have to do what's called a umber underpainting or tonal piece when I used to do portrait work. Ugh, portrait work is the worst. And it's very hard to paint portraits. It's just not to do them accurately, but people are not really happy with their portraits ever, so it's an emotionally challenged gig to take on. You know, but it's what you do when you're doing figurative work is you create this sort of tonal study in umber, kids, that's what they would call that, and then you paint over it. And I like have been loving these watercolor pencils, which I found about, quite honestly, I got a credit. I'm no blowing smoke. I actually found out about them first through Lindsay, and then like immediately after that through my mom. And I was like, I'm switching, because I was doing it with really expensive pastels. And so I switched. I was like, well, if they're both doing it, I'm getting some white paint here, just white, and I'm trying not to thin it too much.
Oh, you go back. Show again. I was off doing something.
I'm just pulling out some white.
Okay.
Painting tip, if it hasn't already happened to you, I should probably do this at the beginning, for moms painting with very, very young little brushes, put out a little paint on a plate and let them just mix it all together, because they're really going to want to. They need to see what's happening there. It's like they can't help it, and if you give them a sacrificial plate so they can realize that all the paint mixed together makes kind of a zombie brown.
Pull your camera over there so we can see a little
then
closer.
Then they'll feel better about conserving their paint. I have a 3-year-old that, you know, I painted with all my kids. And that was probably one of my best things that I started doing, was just letting them have a minute with the paint just to see what happens if you mix all the colors together. And you're like, but the canvas is white. Why am I painting it white? Because you need to paint it white. All the canvas needs to be painted. All the canvas needs to be painted. It's a lot of fun to do. Yeah, so, you know, watch stuff. Go out and learn stuff. There's so much information out there. You know, and even if it's like maybe not totally on a creative topic that you would normally watch, I have started watching some of the crafting and art journaling videos, because they're exposed to art media I never see. It's not for sale at my art store. They don't carry it, and they have some really good ideas. You know, I think sometimes, you know, you get kind of into what you're doing and it feels like there's like one way to do it, but really there's probably a lot of ways of doing it. And it's good to see what other people's ideas are. Because you just can't know there's a couple people I know that actually do know everything. But most of us don't want to live like that. It looks exhausting. It looks very stressful and exhausting to know everything. It's good to know a lot of things, but if you have to know everything to get by, I think it might be really challenging.
You know, Flame Gremlin is...
Hi, Flame Gremlin!
She's out there. She's having a real hard time with one of with a painting instructor that, you know, has told her... and I'm going to have to go back and read the details.
Oh, I can help with this. I've had every kind of painting instructor.
She had some real negative feedback.
Oh, yeah. I love to give that.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, scroll back and see if you can find, because I have some advice. Because here's the thing, in your art journey as you're taking classes, art teachers are just people, and they come with all the crazy that people come with, and sometimes more because they're artists. I have had art teachers that have just really caused me to go breathe in the, like, not the proverbial paper bag, but an actual stored lunch sack. Just trying to calm down from what they said to me. So I have some tool sets for this.
So I guess what happened was is that she had a friend who mm-hmm. went to fine art school.
Okay, they came, do. People go.
Yeah, and she came over and started looking at some of her paintings and her mm-hmm. artwork and mm-hmm. was asking who her art teacher was.
Right.
And then when she told her it was you,
yeah.
She showed her the page, and then she got a ton of discouragement based on the fact that you were her teacher.
Wow.
Apparently her friends suggested that Cinnamon couldn't be a real art teacher because she was doing it for free on YouTube.
Wow. Yeah, that's funny.
And, you know, I had commented there.
You know, I actually think of this. Back when Bob was out, and I'm not saying I'm like Bob. I'm just saying we're kind of similar in that we're teaching in a public space and we're not trying to please the intellectualites of the bougie art world. You know, we're sharing art as something that everyone can do. There's this idea. There's two polar opinions in art. There's the democratized art, which says you don't have to go study in traditional art education methods. You can find education through self, through workshops, through non-traditional processes. And then, of course, there's a traditional art education. Some of those are, like, amazing, and they produce tremendous artists. But the fact is that, you know, Koons is as valid as Grandma Moses. You can't say one artist is more valid than the other. They just got through their journey different paths. And so when people, what I have found in the art world is when artists have to attack what you're doing, it's generally where they're struggling themselves. It's a really interesting thing. If they come up and they're like, you're just too realistic. You're just very, you're an illustrator. When you look at their work, you'll be like, yeah, you could use some of those skills. Little rendering skills might be good in yeah. your art process. You know, a lot of times they attack you for where they're struggling. And there really is no purpose to attacking another artist. It doesn't help them mm-hmm. get a painting done. It doesn't help them get better at their art process. It doesn't help them on their own personal journey. And we can share this awesome experience here today. But at the end of the day, it's you and your canvas. And you're in that together. You and the canvas are in that together. You can get wonderful information from different types of art instructors. And they can show up all kinds of places. Quite frankly, some of the most awesome art stuff I've learned recently was from street artists.
Yeah.
They got some mad stuff going on up there, and it's just all over Houston right now, and it's so exciting. You have to look at what you're getting out of it, and you can be with, like, the most prestigious art education system and get nothing out of it, and be sitting next to somebody who's doodling on a bus and suddenly be like,
"And
I get it. That's just the truth of art."
And I get to watch the channel out here. You guys teach each other as much as we get a chance to teach you. I see you guys answering the questions for one another. We've got a great community here. You know, you guys are doing great out there too.
I'm sorry, because you know what, your friends should not attack friends. Yeah. I mean, not to be overreaching, but that's like, I thought that was, I'm still on my detail brush. I'm kind of like, what was the goal of that?
Yeah, just keep on painting.
It never really bugs me when people come at me, because I can be like, all right, let's take it to the easel.
Right.
That's cool. You feel that way. I haven't really had a problem once that went, like, let's throw canvas up here. Let's work it out. And generally by the end of it, you know, I'm kind of like, oh, all right, are we good now?
But
you know, it's just, but I have a lot of experience with that. When I was coming up in art, all my friends really liked to do comic and anime and very illustrative types, skills in art. And many of them have gone on actually to the comic industry. And that was just the only artwork that community, that part of my art community, was willing to validate. And I just wasn't even interested in doing that.
Yeah, I think that Flame's friend was a realist, and so couldn't had real trouble validating that impressionism and abstracts.
Well, here's the thing. You know, there's some great, you know, realist teachers on YouTube. Like, some amazing ones. There's a guy, Stefan Pabst, that I've just recently got to know, and he does the incredible forced perspective, almost magic trick art. Realism is a skill set, and when you have time, you know, you can do realism. It's just about being able to spend the time and look and work and adjust and look and work and adjust. You know, but then what do you do in your realism practice, you know, beyond that? You know, there's some realist artists out there that I just adore.
Mm-hmm.
You know, go to This is Colossal. If you guys haven't been to This is Colossal, it's an art blog. And this blog curates some of the best artwork from around the world. And you're going to find that what it has in common is exactly what the title of the blog is that it's just colossal.
Mm-hmm.
But it is not one style. It is not one school or thinking of art. It is not one medium. I think his blog is maybe one of the best things for art out there because it demonstrates that art is just every possible expression or idea or process of thing. And, you know, it can't be just one thing. I get real annoyed, like, sometimes when people are like, well, that's not art, that's craft. You know, it's like, well, I don't know. Have you been to the quilting show? Because those people look like artists to me. And I do have a fine art education, and I'm just looking at that through those eyes. I'm painting this black in. I painted it in the eyes and the feet, and now I'm going to come up and paint it on the ears.
Why don't
and
you pull
I like
it up
to
there a little bit. Pull the
zoom, thing up.
Your nausea cam.
My nausea cam. What I like to do when I'm doing stuff like this is sometimes I'll outline it and then fill it in. Right? So, I mean, that's the thing. Like, art is. You want to know what art is? Art is whatever you can put in an alley and walk away from, and somebody will save.
Yeah, it's true.
You know, you're not there. No one's there to justify it. Nobody's there to explain it or tell you the story of why this is awesome. It's just in an alleyway. And if somebody walking by will run off with it, it probably was art to somebody.
Yep.
That was not a popular opinion in art school.
No.
But it's one I held like, go ahead, let's put our artwork out in an alley and we'll see how it does.
Yeah.
Because art is an orphan. It has to live without you at some point. You're not immortal. It is. It's going to maybe go to a resale shop.
That's some deep art for a Kawaii
Panda. For Kawaii Kids. Why do we do this on all
that's
our Kawaii lessons?
That's some we're in some deep philosophical territory. You're going to pull your close-up camera down?
Yeah. What's going on? Lindsay's like, wow, we set it off with cinnamon today.
So gather your 5-year-olds. We're going to talk about art history.
You know what's so funny? But you've seen me teach kids camp, and you know I'll get there with them.
Yeah.
Just like, and they're just looking at me like, why is this lady going bananas?
We're having so much fun, though, doing these shows now.
Yeah.
It's just, you know.
Yeah.
And I'm so excited for to talk, you know, at the, I'll post up a link in the after show where we'll ask questions and we'll be able to go more off script than we already have.
Did we have a script? That's where I went wrong today.
I think our script was, we're going to paint a cute panda.
Well, we are accomplishing that, and I'm sorry I got up on a soapbox. This is what fast forward is for. My dreams that this would be a viral video may not be realized.
Well, I tell you what, we've had about 50 people out here painting with us today, and
Wow. We
appreciate every one of you coming out here.
Really do.
You know, it's been a great time chatting with you, too.
One little thought, depending on the paint that you're painting, you may need to do a couple coats of your black paint or your white paint.
You need to pull your picture up there just a bit.
Yeah, I'm just Woohoo! Hello, little panda. You're so cute today. Go ahead and talk to your panda. It's completely acceptable.
I think Mark's been talking to his panda.
You gotta talk to your artwork. You know what? Seriously, you gotta talk to your artwork. You gotta talk to it. All right. I'm going to. Pull down a little line. It's like a little curve here. And then another little curve. And this is our little kawaii mouth. Keep your brush stroke light. If you make a mistake, dry it with a hair dryer and paint it out. If I don't know why, I'm sure all the kids have left by now, but if there's still kid here,
Gavin's
painting
here.
With their mom. Hi, Gavin.
Yeah, he's here painting along with us. He's very excited.
Hi, Gavin. But if anything ever gets stressful when you're painting with somebody young, just remind them in acrylic paint, you dry it, you paint over it, you do it over. There's no mistakes that you can't just fix or correct or change. It's just all fine. That's, believe it or not, I think because of the school system, the kids get a lot of anxiety going when it comes to art.
Yeah.
We're going to put in our happy, weird little clouds. I am very fond of these clouds. I got a nice little small, tight little filbert here.
It's a baby filbert.
Baby filbert. This is a number 6.
Mm.
So, you know, that's how, if you're like looking at it just in case.
Is it half the 12?
Let's see. Is it half the 12? It could be half the 12.
There you go. So it's probably a quarter inch.
I can't. Here, I'll do this.
Yeah, we're okay.
There. Nausea cam. Focus.
So it's about a quarter inch filbert.
Yeah. Quarter inch filbert. Just let you guys see that. Smaller. And what it is it gives me some control over what I'm doing. This is a really fun cloud to know how to do. A neat trick is I'm going to start it off the canvas over here.
You pull your close-up camera.
I'm going to pull my close-up camera so we can see it. But big art hugs, Flame Gremlin. Big art hugs. She won our feather.
Oh, that's right. She did.
She's the winner of the feather.
We have to get that sent off to her.
Yep. Random comment picker said her. I love random comment picker. Because then I'm absolved of all. I make a nice little round shape here. It's about, a dime size. And then I'm going to come over a little bit. And I'm going to make a slightly maybe bigger round shape, but that's skinnier. See, they're like little bump bumps. Go bump bump.
Mm-hmm.
Bumpity bumpity bump bump bump. And then it's going to have a little smooshier friend that comes down using these round brush strokes. And then his last little friend is going to ski out like this. And then we're going to take the bottom flat. And that's an important part of this cloud, is take that bottom flat. Now, on this, I'm not going to do a couple strokes to make sure that none of the blue shows through, because I'm letting the blue do some of my work for me. Right? I'm letting that blue do some of my work, giving my cloud some, like, little fluffiness and shape. And you can even play with that if you want to in your cloud. Play with the fluffiness and shape. Get a little water on my brush so the paint stays fluid, and I'm gonna come visit this part of my sky. I feel like there needs to be some more cloud over here. Just a lone little bastion over here just floating up in the sky. So I'm gonna make my little round dime sort of shape. And he's gonna have a little friend that puffs out over here, as they do. And then maybe a little squishier, lower rounded friend. Then maybe somebody small and kind of regular there. Take it out. He could go behind the panda. He cannot go behind the panda either. Either is okay. I think we made my panda even bigger on this one. This will happen. I'm just like painting along because I'm not using the traceable. I just freehand these little suckers in. And flat on the bottom. So that's that happy little cloud just floating up there in the sky. Now, if you want to make these clouds even more kawaii, you can do the little kawaii faces in the cloud. That's sort of fun. You could kawaii your whole space. And if your kid's feeling the urge to do the two little dots and the funny expressions in the clouds, That's probably where they get it from, is they probably have seen that in some of their favorite art.
Can you pull that the camera down again?
Down. And they're probably just trying to express that. And they'll do that, you know, just let them go off the reservation a little bit, you know. It's a balance with kids when you're painting at home. And it's also a balance with yourself, which is allowing a lot of expression and then also just making sure some basic skills are getting covered. So there we go. How is that looking?
That's looking really cute.
Cute. Cutie cute.
You gonna take a sippy-sippy break?
Sippy-sippy break? My sippy-sippy getting cold.
Is it?
I love my controversy cup. I don't know. I've been calling it the whole season.
Mark is painting ahead.
Is there a way to show anybody this? I can't see it there. Hi, Mark. Painting along. We see you. He's ahead. Because he has the picture. So he's like, I think I can work it out. I think that's what Mark is saying. I think I've worked out the... the thing. Yeah, now if you're, anywhere you're at, where if you're in an art class or you're with friends or you're anywhere, there's always going to be somebody that might run into your day. Not every time, but like there are people that will run into your day and they'll have something to say. Like my mom is a tremendous painter. She's been published everywhere. We've shown all over the country. We've done all the stuff. But there have been people who walk up and just... have a lot of opinion, you know, and the only opinion you really need to listen to, and I guess is yourself's opinion is a good one to listen to, and maybe your collector, like if you're doing a commission, you should maybe listen to that person's opinion a little bit or a peer or somebody who's coming from a good space. But everybody gets it. My mom had an art agent once that said it's gonna be good.
No, I'm going to do some bad stuff.
No more bad stuff. She's like, what we're selling? What are we talking about? She's like, I can't sell pink.
So.
People will say crazy stuff to you that you've just got to deal with. I'm going to get my detail brush out.
There's our panda.
And one of the things that I'm going to do is I'm going to put in some happy little flowers. And that is, I'm just going to pull out a little bit of my yellow. And pull my white in. I'm going to mix some yellow and white. It's going to be kind of a ducky color. Baby duck color. Fluid enough to come off my brush. And I'm going to come here and I'm going to make some little buttons. And
yeah,
I'm
going to...
I caught it this time.
Yeah, I saw it.
Woohoo! I'm on top of it today. John's like waiting for me. And it's like just a little kind of... elongated circle cut in half. Then I'm going to face a button back this way, cut in half. And then I'm going to face a button straight up, cut in half. And that's all. If you think about flowers, right? If you think about little flowers, they're not orderly. Are they? They like to be
not
all kinds
all.
Of goofy places. Just doing what flowers feel like doing. There's that. And then I'm going to face another little button this way. Maybe these flowers are having a moment. They're not talking. Or they're singing to different birds in the sky. I don't know. It's your world. You've heard that before, but it's true. Yep. Yes, John?
So they're looking at different clouds.
Different clouds. Yeah. I mean, it's not like I'm going to come and say, oh, I have given this assignment and then grade it. So if you're like, I really am not into, you know, this type of Cosmo Daisy, I want to do some other kind of flower. I'm not going to come to your Facebook page and be like, hey.
Although I would like to see it. So post pictures because I want to see the variations.
Post pictures. If I come to your Facebook page, it's going to be like to say, oh, good job.
Awesome.
I don't really cause trouble on Facebook.
Can you scroll over there so we see
I
one?
Can. See, I didn't get you that. I wasn't prepared that time. I like to add a little white to this. It's incredibly helpful. It's incredibly helpful. Yeah. Incredibly helpful. right? And just put that there, and it's happy. Oh, wait, I have one more little daisy to put, but I think I may do it after I do my stem because I want an exact curve. Once I've got that there, I'm going to make a little green. And we remember how we're making green, which is the yellow and blue make a nice green. And I'm going to let it be a little darker than my other green because it's a stem. And I'm going to come from the bottom of my dot with a curved line. And maybe I'll make some leaves here.
Pull that over there so we can see it.
Pull it over there. Where am I at? Thank you for catching that, sweetheart. He's so good. He helps me so much. You guys just have no idea. Or maybe you do. Maybe you're like, oh, she's so lucky to have John there. It would be crazy without John.
I think this is a two-person or more job.
It really is. And I just, whenever you see an art YouTuber out there doing live, give them love.
Yeah.
Because this is some hard work, guys. Any of them. If you see one of us in the art and craft sector putting live content out there for it, give them likes, give them shares, give them encouragement. This is not an easy system to use yet. They have not made this easy. They're trying to make it easy, but it isn't there yet.
There's a couple technical hurdles.
And we are some brave, crazy people to be doing this. You know, it is literally a labor of love. It is literally a labor of love. All right, here you go. So I've got those in, and once I have... Oh, wait, I forgot. I rinsed out, and I needed one more stem. That happens. Sometimes you forget a whole part of your painting. You walk away, and you look at it, and you're like, wait, what? It happens. I'm going to tell a little kind of bent over little flower story here. And I wanted to do my stem before I did my yellow dot. So I had a little control over where the little objects on it went. Making this little diamond shape for a leaf and maybe another little diamond shape for a leaf just for fun. And then I can put my yellow dot in once I knew where that is, and it's a little easier to put in. And I've got some of that paint left over that I can pick up and put in. You guys, one thing I really want to tell you, and I've got to start telling you more often, is I put out way more paint than you should put out. Way more.
Pull your close-up camera there. Up a little.
Up a little bit. So when I'm putting out my paint, I'm dealing with really hot lights. Like, it's amazing that I don't melt while I'm filming. And it dries out my paint really quickly. And I also want you to kind of be able to really see what I'm doing. And so I put out just much more than is needed. I'm going to get a little of my white and a little of my quinacridone. Now I can't say it. Quinacridone?
Yeah.
Oh, no. Now I'm going to get more of the phonic spelling.
Of course you will. About 30 of them.
Actually, guys, I don't mind that at all. When you guys joke with me, we think it's awesome. I have an incredible sense of humor. I am, to the good and the bad, hard to offend. Sometimes it's bad to be hard to offend because you don't really necessarily get it when you're ticking people off. But then on the other hand, I have a real tolerance for a lot of sense of humor. So when you guys like throw off a joke at me, I'm like, meh, you know what I mean? Or you guys say it, I just don't take it in general the wrong way. John can tell you.
The Quinac.
Quinac.
Quinac. You're zoomed.
We're going to zoom in.
We're good.
Okay, we're good? We're going to do these little petals. And this is just this little brush stroke where I place the brush down and just sort of pull out and make these little dabs. That's all it is. Pretty simple stuff. Right, guys? This is a really simple painting. This is a great one. You can give this. I've noticed a lot of baby shower gifts have been getting made from these. And I initially started doing these just because I was like, oh, wait, I'm on YouTube for kids. I should probably make sure I've got some content for the 5 kids that might watch my watch my show. And
hey, we got more than 5 kids in here now.
I know. We do now, but I wasn't sure how that was going to be. And I just wanted to make sure that there was some things that they would be interested in maybe painting.
Oh.
And I'm coming up. Now, one of the things I'm doing is my little brush strokes. I'm trying to, it's hard to keep my hand out of the way and show you what I'm doing. They're getting smaller and they're kind of curving around and they go in. It sort of just tells that there's a wind happening there that's pulling my petals away. How do you tell stories on your canvas? Lots of ways to tell stories. Color is a way to tell stories. The objects that you render in is a way to tell stories. How things are layered is a way. Brush strokes. All ways to tell stories. And we're just making up stories. This is not real. This is made up. This is imagination. Tough to put a grade or value on imagination.
So, let's see here. Flame says, my 5-year-old wants to make purple, but cad red and phthalo blue are not working for her.
Don't make purple.
They don't make purple.
They don't make purple.
What color do they make?
Oh, show you. Okay. it's a beautiful color for me, and I paint with it, but it is not purple. So I've got my quinacridone here, and I've got my cad here, and I'm really off topic. But what this is cad red here has a very powerful yellow in it. And so what do yellow and blue make?
Green.
Green. And what do green and red make?
Gray.
Gray.
Ah.
So when you mix phthalo blue with cad red, you get this kind of gorgeous grayed out putty I'll show you right now. I know I'm off the reservation, guys, but maybe this is something that you wanted to know. I don't know. So we can see that. And this is how I get my brick, isn't it? Whenever we're mixing colors, this is how I get my kind of weird brick tones.
Oh, yeah.
When I'm trying to deepen it out, gray it out. Now, here's some fun. This also works with crimson, what I'm about to do. Okay?
Okay.
So if you have the quinacridone or a crimson, this will work, and phthalo. You can see where the skin is starting to pull up. Me get some here, we can see it. Can I thin it?
Oh, yeah, you can see that purple there.
Yeah, it's a gorgeous purple. Here, I'll add some white to it. See that gorgeous purple?
I do.
So that's how you get a gorgeous purple with blue and red. Now, that's the thing. And if you were to use true primary colors, you would get purple with blue and red. Phthalo blue and quinacridone. Quinacridone.
Yep, got the Q word.
Red.
If you ever make it to Passamaquoddy, you can buy some.
Yes! I wish we had the rights to Pete's Dragon right now. It's like, oh, Passamaquoddy. Anyways, it will make you beautiful purples, but that's the issue with the cad red and the... I know I just went off the reservation, but hopefully that's sort of informative to everybody as to why. And that's why I'm kind of glad to add this color into the palette, and we're going to add a couple more. We always have Naphthol Crimson listed in the list for that very reason.
So you can just grab it and swap them?
Yeah, and you can make some beautiful, beautiful purples with the Naphthol Crimson and the Phthalo Blue.
Cool.
Yeah. All right, so back to the petals.
Grab your close-up camera.
Grab my close-up camera. Was that helpful?
Yeah, I think there's lots of thank yous.
Okay, cool. Okay, cool.
Drat you, Sherpa, for teaching us how to paint purple.
Well, at some point, I guess we have to do some color mixing work.
Yeah.
You know, it's sort of like the drills of the art world, where you make your little color book, and you draw these little squares, and you mix some colors. And, you know, you have a little blast. Now, I'm going to take these petals all the way around here because I'm saying that this flower is at an angle where it would do that. So I'm just taking those around. Just have fun with that. It's not that serious of stuff. It's not that serious. Don't take your artwork too seriously. I spent a lot of years of my life taking my artwork too seriously. And the problem with that is that you don't have all the joy and fun that you can have if you don't.
Can you show me how you loaded that brush there?
Okay, yeah.
Because you just did a lot of work there.
Spin it.
Yeah.
Roll it out. And then load it.
Okay, can the close-up camera show you what you've got on the tip there? Oh, don't break the painting.
Stay! Okay. Is it working?
Okay, it's coming. There it is. Okay, so just the tip. So it's wet, but just the tip has the blob of paint.
Just the tip.
Gotcha. Okay.
Is that helpful?
That is very helpful.
Okay, cool. I like to be helpful. I like to be very, very, very helpful. It's good stuff. It's good, good, good stuff. Yeah, you know, you just miss out on the fun of what art is actually for, you know? And as I kind of came up in the art world and got to meet other really awesome professional artists, one of the things that I've learned is that the people who really, really work in this business have walked away from that overly, you know, taking themselves overly seriously and have embraced more that they get to do what they love for fun. You know, even though they might have good business practices.
Yeah.
Yeah. Otherwise, you're just miserable.
You pull your camera up if you're going to paint on the head.
I'm going to paint that head right there. I'm going to give it a bow. My daughter. So the bow. Now, if you have a boy panda, panda doesn't need a bow, right? But my daughter was like, this panda really, really needs a bow. So I mixed a very strong pink here. It may take two coats because we're painting over black. And then I make a heart. This is how I get my bow shape. That's all it takes, a little heart. And I'll come back with another layer of pink to pop this. And again, never be afraid if it's going to take two tries. Don't be afraid. So the bow is my daughter. She was like, it has to have a bow or it's not.
The bow.
Yeah. So I was like, all right, we can bow it up. She's such a sweetheart. And then her sister, her younger sister, Luna, was like, well, if she gets that panda, then I get a white kitty, right? And then my son's like, well, are you going to make a robot? I'm
like, all right, sure. Close the camera.
Thank you. So I'm going to do the little pads of the feet. And they're super simple. So I just make a nice little circle. And I just go swirly, swirly, swirly. Tip of my brush, light pressure. You know, get the size that you like, get the pinkness that you like, wherever you're at.
It's kind of hard to see you around your hand there sometimes, so I'm having to go to the, it's okay, I'm just going to the long camera.
Oh, I know, and that's the only thing, like, I really want to be able to see the hand.
Yeah.
Now I'm going to make, at the top of the toe, one little circle for one little teeny tiny toe. Come over to the right, make another little circle for another little teeny tiny toe, and to the left, a circle for a teeny tiny toe. So sorry for the soapboxing today, guys. You know, the worst thing about art school is art school. You can get really lost in there about what matters. What is important? I loved going, but then, you know, I had Dr. Clarence Talley as my art professor, who was, it was like going to the Tyler Perry School of Art. It was pretty awesome, and, you know, so I think I was set straight early on.
Yeah.
Because one thing my prof had, the head of our art department, was a joy of creation. Really connected that to his faith and his spirit, and he did create from such a place of total joy and did not tolerate morose, angsty, emo nonsense at all.
No.
No, broke me of that craziness right away.
Uh-huh.
He was like, and he would just call you on your stuff, and he was a really good influence on me and probably set me forward on some really good foundational...
Why don't you pull your camera up there a little?
Sorry. I'm just going to do that second coat on that bow. He gave me some good foundational work about why do we create, and what is it about? I mean, what is its purpose? Because it's not like the world is short of another painting. Great paintings have been done. The world has some. So at some point, you're creating for the experience that you get to have out of it, right? The joy being creative brings into your life. The silliness and the fun you get to participate in because you've embraced being creative. And now we are down to the last little bit, right? You're going to pull some white And you're going to want it to be, see, it's already skinning on my, this is why I put out the amount I do. And I could mist it, but I didn't mist it today, so. I use sometimes to keep my palette from drying out. This is a good, if you've seen my, how to make a at-home wet palette.
Yep.
With cake plate. You could use Tupperware, too. I'm just like, I got a cake plate for free from Kroger, so I was like, ah, make a wet palette years ago. I'm going to, on the inside of the eye, I'm leaving a salvage edge for those people who sew. You know, just a little outer edge. I make this little line, this little smooth white line. Pull out some more white. And I do that thing where I just roll the brush, pick up your tip. Roll the brush gently down the stream. Merrily, life is but a dream. Content ID.
Yeah.
All right, so we've done his little in lines. Right. And then we're going to just do a reflection dot. I'm going to really pick up a nice bit of paint for this. And this is when you really you've got to roll it and get it, because you want it nice and loaded on the tip. Nice reflection dot. You could even do a second reflection dot if you want it to be even more cutier.
Even more eye watery. You could even
do one down here. I mean, there's really no end to the reflection dots you can do. It's kind of a hysterical thing. Woohoo! Little Kawaii Panda. With my Game of Thrones. Maybe that's what it is. I mixed up the Game of Thrones and I went all Katniss. I can't really see me being a tribute for anything. Come meet me at the Q&A if you still have any energy for that.
Yeah.
I want to see you painting and creating and laughing and seeing your friends and loving life and being creative at the easel really soon. Go check out my fellow YouTubers, my fellow art and craft YouTubers. There's some bananas stuff here. In fact, we call it YouTube University, so...
And share your picture. We want to see it. We want to see your picture painted up, posted up.
Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, anywhere. Happy to see it.
Yep. We love you guys. Thank you for joining us. Talk to you guys.
In a minute.
We're going to go see you at the after party.
After party.
Live. Bye-bye.